good, successful, long-term investors? Two. Okay, and how many of us think that we are good at both? Well, we certainly have one, Mr. Parijat Garg. Parijat is a rare individual who has enjoyed success at two extremes of financial markets, very long-term investing and short-term, ultra-short-term algorithmic trading. Parijat is an algorithmic investor and entrepreneur with 11 years of systematic trading experience. He is a computer science engineer from IIT Bombay and a CFA charter holder since 2011. Currently, he is Senior Vice President at IIFL Asset Management. Before joining IIFL, Parijat co-founded Toffler, a private company search platform. He began his career with Tower Research Capital, now a global leader in high-frequency algorithmic trading. Parijat also maintains a concentrated equity portfolio built on long-term value investing principles. He strongly believes that it is possible to create wealth using a wide variety of techniques. All it requires is skill, discipline, and a bit of luck. As an investor, he is on a quest to understand what makes a business great and what makes a great investment. To pursue his goal, he talks to people, reads a lot, and uses computer programming. He believes that we must think carefully about the goal we wish to achieve and then remove as many obstacles between our goal and the task. Recently, he started curating videos relating to investing and business excellence on YouTube under channel name The Inquisitive Investor. Do watch the channel for many interesting videos. His childhood hero is Bill Gates. He wanted to meet him when he was 10 years old. And later on, he thought that I would create something that Bill Gates would like to meet me. So I guess, finger crossed. Then somewhere I saw that you said, growing up is the process of losing your heroes. You haven't lost yours. So good. Thanks for coming here to share your experience. And so without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Mr. Parijat Garg.
Thanks, Deepak. You've done major research clearly into what I've said. I think it's a good reminder that we should be careful about what we write in public. People can really dig into it. Anyways, so as Deepak said, and as Jatin also suggested, and I think everybody who's been in the markets long enough suggests that there's really no one way to make money, right? Clearly, that's become established. You can be a day trader, you could be bully trading, you could be investing for the long term, you could be a momentum investor, you could be a value investor, you could be distressed opportunities investor, all sorts of things. Everything can work as long as we are systematic about it. And in some ways, you know, what I'm going to talk about today is related to that. It's sort of carried on to an extreme. Right, the level of systematicness and what that sort of entails, what there are certain things that you have to give up to become extremely systematic, and then there are upsides to that as well. So we'll talk about that and how that affects everybody who's not even necessarily what you would call an algorithmic investor, how it affects everybody who's participating in the markets. We'll sort of talk about that. To start though, what is an algorithm? Somebody wants to volunteer a definition?
Step-by-step execution of steps.
Okay. Step-by-step execution of
instructions.
Instructions.
Linear equation.
a linear equation. Okay, that's one sort of algorithm.
Set of rules.
A set of rules. All right. Okay. So, set of rules is one part of it, and then step by step execution of those against those rules. That's the other part of it. That's sort of the combination. So the execution bit is also very important. So a set of rules, for example, just to your point, even a checklist is in some sense a set of rules, right? You would have that, you know, a company should be generating cash flows, etc. You can have that list, but that would not really qualify in and of itself as an algorithm. An algorithm implies the taking of certain actions and then sort of coming up with a decision and then executing on that decision, etc. That's what an algorithm is. In the context of investing, then, an algorithmic investing strategy or algorithmic investing just means that you have a series of steps that you are going to follow for the process of investing. That just means you've got I'm going to get XYZ data, and then I'm going to look at it in a certain way, and then this is how I'm going to decide whether to buy or not buy, and then buy or not buy. So a rules-based process, right, to generate buy, sell, and sizing decisions. Now, the rules-based part is very clear, but it's also important to remember that the buy, sell, and sizing decisions bit is also very important. So for example, you cannot have a system that just says, you know, the relative strength indicator is at 80, right? You've done the math, you've come up with the number. But an algorithm is going to tell you, when the RSI is above 80, we have to, well, if you're a momentum investor, you want to buy. If you're a reversion investor, you want to sell. That rule also has to be part of the system to qualify as an algorithm, right? So you have the process to generate buy, sell, and sizing decisions. In the case of investing, should also tell you, should you put in 2% of your portfolio, 5% of your portfolio, whatever. So the action that you have to take also has to come from your system. It cannot come from, you know, I know the RSI and then the decision is coming from some subjective process. That's not, that will not make an algorithm. That's not a complete algorithm. Now, if you are a value investor, right, you will, or any kind of fundamental discretionary investor, you're going to think, you know, but there are lots of things that I do that you cannot really put down as a rule. In fact, Jatin mentioned, right, it's a world of serendipity when you're investing. You can't have a set process. There's certain things that Jatin does, you know, which is soft. You meet the management, you understand whether this person can actually execute. And how do you actually put that into a process? You can't really quantify everything, right? And I agree. Not everything that goes into investing can be measured or quantified, and therefore cannot really be turned into a systematic algorithmic strategy. So now, I'll follow up on that. Before that, I'm going to ask you a question. So there's a guy called Ritwik Bose, okay? And I'm going to tell you a few things about him, very few things. He's a 40-year-old man from Kolkata, right? And he loves reading books by Rabindranath Tagore. Right? There's something we know about this person. The show of hands, if I were to ask you to guess whether this person is a librarian or is he a software engineer, how many people think he's likely to be a librarian? How many people think he might be a software engineer? What does everybody else think he is? I'm telling you, he's one of the two. So between the two of these things, you know, it should be all hands. So how many people he thinks he's a librarian? Provided this is just one of two things he can be. Okay. Mind you now, everybody else has to raise their hand for engineer. Okay, there's an even split. Fine. Well, so if that is the all the information I gave you about this person, I mean, there's obviously a lot of other information you might need to make a good guess. But if this is all that you knew about this person, the correct guess, like literally the correct guess, would be engineer. That he's a software engineer. Can somebody say why?
There are more software engineers than librarians.
It's just the sheer number of software engineers compared to the number of librarians. So if you just, you know, throw a stone at somebody, is more likely to be a software engineer than... So even if librarians say there are, I think it's easy to say that there are 20 times more software engineers than librarians, right? And now if every librarian loves reading books by Rabindranath Tagore and only 5% of software engineers like reading Rabindranath Tagore, then you're going to get like an even probability, right? So this is basically what is known as base rate, right? That the underlying statistics of what you are trying to predict is so skewed in one direction that, you know, this you have to really pay attention to that. You cannot just have this bias. If somebody is reading Rabindranath Tagore, more likely to be this librarian kind of person. It doesn't matter. Like statistically, the base rate suggests that he's going to be a software engineer. To guess otherwise, you should know more about this person before you can say something. Sort of taking this sort of same thing, looking at it from a stock market perspective, right? A typical screen that people use when you're generating ideas, you will say, okay, I'm going to start with the large and mid caps in India. So you go to screener.in and you'll say, I'm looking for companies with greater than 5,000 crores in market cap, right? That's your thing. Then you're going to filter for quality, because that's what you've been told. You want to look for high quality stocks. And your definition for quality is that, you know, stocks with high ROE, let's say 15%. So you're saying companies with market cap of greater than 5,000 crores with ROEs of greater than 15%. And then you're going to say it should be cheap. So you're going to say, okay, I want a stock that's less than 2x price to book. You do that. You come up with a list. And Jatin, any idea what kind of number of stocks are going to meet this criteria today? I'm guessing maybe like 40 stocks, right? 40 stocks will meet this criteria. Maybe. Then what you will do is you'll say, okay, these are my, this is my short list. Then I'm going to start digging into it deeper. And then I'm going to maybe come up with three ideas that I can buy, right? But here's the thing. If you don't believe that all 40 of these have a higher than average chance to outperform the market, then the screen is pretty much worthless. Right? So you've basically said, here are 1700 stocks, I've run this screen, I've come up with 40 names, these 40 names, and I'm going to do more work on it. But there's another thing you could do. You could take all of these 40 stocks and say, I'm going to put my money evenly in all of these companies. And yes, there might be some that will underperform and some that will outperform, but on average, if this basket of stocks does not outperform the market, then the screen is probably going to be very little useful. Right? There's not too much that you have done by running the screen, because if they don't perform on average, your base rate is not in support of your work, right? So, and here we've done everything is very statistical, right? This is all mathematics. You've not gone into any of the soft aspects. Is this industry growing? Is this management a good management? So you've not done anything of that sort. But yet, this screen should produce something that is relatively would either safer or has higher returns on average than the market. Otherwise, probably not very useful, right? So algorithmic investing then is basically betting on the base rate. You're saying, I'm going to get my process to a point where I can do all of it systematically, quantitatively, and then whatever gets, you know, comes out of that, I'm going to bet on all of it, right? And some of them, there might be soft issues that come out, etc. But on the whole, statistically, because there is a big sample of investments I'm looking at, statistically, I will make money. That is basically what algorithmic investing is, right? And if this is not working, then, if this does not work, then your initial hypothesis about whether a high ROE company at a low price to book is on average a good idea, that is something that you want to reconsider. If this does not work, right? Even if you're a value investor, by the way, even if you are going to eventually dig into these companies and choose a subset of these companies, you should question this screen in the first place if it does not work like this. If the base rate is not playing out, there is no value that the screen is adding to your process. So base rate means that in this case, if I take these 40 stocks as a basket, then this basket should perform better than whatever your benchmark is that you're trying to beat, right? So eventually you want to pick out some from this. So you want to even, by your discretionary process, you want to outperform this basket. But this basket itself should be outperforming the market. Otherwise the screen is not particularly useful. Right? So algorithmic investing just says, I'm going to stop the process right there. I'm not going to do any of the soft stuff. I'm just going to make sure that everything is quantitative, and then I'll bet on that. So effectively, by avoiding what is known as base rate neglect, this fact that we said that this person might be a librarian was an example of base rate neglect, where you did not think about the fact that there are just so many more software engineers that this person is more likely to be a software engineer. That is base rate neglect. Now, if you want immunity from base rate neglect in your process, then the price that you have to pay is this thing, that whatever you do has to be measurable, right? Because if you cannot measure it, measure the things that you are going to base your decision on, there is no way to find out the base rate. Right? If you say, for example, I think companies with great quality management do better than the market on average over time. Right? Sounds like a good hypothesis, except if you do not define what good management means, there is no way to test if this worked over the last 10 years. Right? Can you go back to 2009, right, and say, okay, if I had picked companies with great quality management, it would have done well. And the first question is, okay, how do you define great management? Right? And if you can't do that, then there is no way to test your hypothesis. Right? So it does nothing for you in terms of, so again, history, you can actually do this over 10 years and think about, this is what I think great management is on a soft basis. You build a portfolio, you run it for 5 years, and you say, okay, yes, I've actually managed to beat the market. And by the way, there's still signal to noise problems there, but after 5 years, you might actually be able to figure out whether this is true or not. But if you want to systematically look back in history and be able to say whether this particular hypothesis is true, you need to be able to quantify what a great management is. Otherwise, here's the thing. You might still think, well, I can look at the 2009 Nifty 50 companies, and I can look at that and I can say this was great management, etc., and then they have done well. But the problem here is you've got survivorship bias, you've got hindsight bias, where you just know. So if you went back to 2006 or 2007, I imagine, right before the Satyam crash, right, the scandal, I think it was just 2 months before Raju came out and said that I've been taking out money, etc. Just 2 months before that, the company had won the Golden Peacock for corporate governance. Okay, so it is, we may think now that it was always understood. If you looked at the financials of Satyam, you would understand that there was a problem. The reality at that point of time is always very different. So unless you can quantify what would make a great management, you cannot really backtest the hypothesis in the financial markets, right? So you want to be able to measure base rates, that's just the price you're going to have to pay. You will have to drop all soft aspects from your process and say, I'm going to stick to what I can measure.
So, coming back to the previous slide, when you say the need for visibility will be less if you go with the base rate.
No, the other way around. If you want to be able to bet on base rates and to test hypothesis statistically, you have to give up everything but measurable stuff. If you cannot measure it, you cannot test whether it statistically works or not. Right? And there's a lot of work that is done on defining great management. For example, you can say that, so one metric that is often used is return on reinvested capital. Right? If a company manages to generate great returns on reinvested capital over a 10-year period, that's a very good sign that that's great management. But that's your definition of great management. If you're willing to say, that's what I'm going to call great management, fantastic. Now you can backtest that if a company has generated great returns on reinvested capital for the last 10 years, it is likely to do better than the average company going forward. You can test this hypothesis and it might work, and in which case you've got a strategy. So, to avoid base rate neglect, the definition of algo investing has to have one more word in there. It has to be an objective rules-based process. Okay. So now, I'll go back to saying what the issue with just saying rules-based is. Supposing you say, simple, I'm going to be an investor that buys companies at low price to earnings, and I'm going to sell them when they become high on the price to earnings metric. So this sounds like an objective rule, except that it's not an objective rule, right? Because who is to say what a low price to earning multiple is? There could be any number of definitions. You could say a price to earnings of 10 is low, or you could say two standard deviations below the historical price earning multiple of that stock. Right? There's just any number of ways to define what a low price to earnings multiple means. But if you don't nail it down, again, you cannot backtest. You cannot say, if you had bought companies with low price to earning multiple over the last 10 years, you would have made money, until you actually say what that means. Right? So this objectivity really has to be part of the process if you say that you're doing algo investing. So this is a bigger question. For a lot of people in the audience here, you might say, look, and like Jatin said, when you start, everybody is a bottom-up investor, and you know, fundamentals matter and management matters and soft stuff. That's what really matters. And you might say, I don't care about this. Why should I care about specific statistics and price to earnings multiples? I don't care. I should not bother. Except that you should. Here's why. So Michael Morbison is a very well-known he teaches a course somewhere, but he's also an investor, long-time investor. Great guy, does great stuff. And this is one thing that he says that's very, very important. Right? If you buy or sell a security in the market, you have to know, you know, who's on the other side of it. Why is he selling that security to you at a given price? Or why is he buying it from you at a given price? And the important thing here is that today, it is very likely that the counterparty is actually an algorithm. Right? It's a very large percentage of transactions of all markets everywhere in the world are actually done by algorithms. Whether it's high frequency, or whether it's a systematic investing fund, whether it's an ETF, the counterparty is running on rules. Right? There's no soft stuff happening. They're running on rules. So if you don't understand this system, this whole objective, systematic way of buying and selling, you don't understand half your counterparties. And if you don't understand half your counterparties, you're going to be in trouble. For example, right? And it was nice that somebody brought this up. I would have brought it up anyways. This question of, right? Again, sorry, disclaimer. I don't even remember. I might have somebody in my family might have shared the but this question, right? I remember another time when people said if you get it below 30 times earning, it was no brainer, just back up the truck and buy it. Today it's selling at 20 times earnings, and everybody like, maybe you want to think about it, maybe it's not an FMCG stock, etc. Why is that? Because, well, lots of investors are saying ESG, etc. But there are in fact now ESG funds, right? And they've got systematic ways to assess whether something is, valid for buying or not for buying, right? So unless you understand that there are, you know, there's these scoring rules and they'll say, not meet that criteria, you don't understand why you're getting in at 29 earnings and what risk you are running. By maybe over the next 10 years, these funds become even more and more important and you will never get a multiple expansion. And it's possible that that can happen. But to know that this is happening because there are these forces where these funds are being created and there are these, in fact, people are now, I think BlackRock or somebody even suggesting that they'll create indexes within the S&P 500. This is an S&P 500 index, except, you know, minus the bad ESG stocks, right? And if more and more money pours into that, you're lost, and all your fundamental thinking, etc., could be potentially lost unless you understand your counterparty. So just for that, if nothing else, you need to understand how quant investing works, and I'll explain how more and more of it is actually becoming. I think I'm getting ahead of myself here, but to think that these are dumb algorithms that just work on price to book and price to earnings, etc., would actually be naive, and I'll explain why, how, in fact, that landscape is changing. Right now, before we get into how these things actually work, why does it work? Right? It works because they are objective, they are less prone to greed and fear and those kinds of things. That's fairly obvious. The other thing is backtestability. Any hypothesis we might have about high ROE companies delivering good returns, etc., when you quantify them, you can backtest these ideas. So if there's any flaw in your thinking, you don't have to wait 10 years or you don't have to come and listen to Jatin's lecture to understand what you should not do. You can actually just sit and backtest this strategy. And if there's a flaw in your thinking, you can fix it and test again. Fix it and test again, right? And so that's basically something that gives you a lot of power. You don't actually lose money if you can backtest stuff. The third thing, this is major. So again, Jatin said it takes two cycles to learn how markets behave, etc. Right? And every time this new crop of people come into the market, they're going to spend 10 years learning about this. But algorithms, you know, the learnings are cumulative. Anything that you've once coded in, if you think of it as an organization, once that is part of your process, it's written down. Nobody has to come in and learn the psychology of markets, etc. It's there, it's coded. So everything incrementally just gets better and better. It's compounding in a different way. So there's compounding of money and then there's compounding of learning. So when you have a systematic, quantified algo, the learnings accumulate, they compound, they get better. And that gives a massive edge over time. I mean, everybody as an investor understands the power of compounding. That is one big source. They also go away though, by the way. So markets evolve, right? And you have to revise these rules. But as a general thing, the most basic mistakes are eliminated and they're eliminated forever. The other things are, they are scalable. So if I work something out that works for the Indian markets, it's very likely that with minor tweaks, it can work across the globe, get massive scale and replicability, and it can be extremely fast. So get into a nuts and bolts quickly so that the later stuff makes more sense. There are multiple types of strategies that algos can have. There can be directional strategies. It's just outright you bet on a security going up or down, etc. You can have forecasts. Then there are long shot strategies where you make relative value bets. I'm assuming most of you are familiar with the basic idea of directional long shot. There's market making where you actually don't take a directional view. Right? All you are doing is scalping. You are putting bid and offer, you're making the spread. There are lots and lots of algo strategies that do that. And then there is pure arbitrage. So pure arbitrage is really not the subject here, but things like arbitrage between the LSE and BSE or the cash and futures, etc. This is classic. This is typically the domain of very high-speed algorithms, but as a category, it's there, so we should sort of know that it exists. This is the more interesting thing. What actually goes into this decision making? Right? As fundamental investors, you can look at obviously the fundamentals, the financials and the shareholding and things like that. You can look at the daily market data that you get, the bulk copy or whatever, the open high low close, you can look at charts, etc. These are still price data, volume data. You can look at macroeconomic data, whether certain sectors are growing, whether the interest rates are favorable to a particular kind of business or an industry, etc. That's obviously part of the process. So this is easy to understand even for algos, because this is typically numerical data that you can put into any kind of system. You could say that I'll only buy rate sensitive when the rates are going down, etc. You can put that into an algorithm. It's pretty straightforward. The stuff in the lower half of this is actually the more interesting bit. So news today is a very big part of algo investing for a lot of funds out there. It's a little hard to understand how news, something so incredibly subjective, right, could be part of an algo process, where I just said it has to be extremely objective. And you can't just say, if it is good news, I'll buy the stock. You can't do that because you have to define what good means, etc. But a lot of work has now been done where the most simple thing that people do with news is they'll create what is known as a sentiment score. They'll look at a piece of news and they'll come up with a score of how positive or negative that piece of news is for a company. But then there's more. So people have started extracting event information. So systems can now read a news article and figure out whether it is saying that there is a labor strike at a particular plant of a particular company. The moment you can get this out systematically, you can build a strategy and you can backtest it, right? You could look at 10 years of news and you can see whether whenever there was a strike in a plant for a company, did the stock react negatively over the next 1 week, 1 month, whatever. And you can build a strategy, you can backtest it, as long as you have a systematic way of extracting this information. And this is increasingly happening. The fifth is high frequency data. By the way, high frequency means a lot of different things to different people. So to traditional investors, high frequency data is anything that you get on a monthly basis, right? So because the company's financials you get on a quarterly basis, if you are getting the PMI data that is every month, or you're getting auto sales data every month, they tend to call it high frequency data. Right? This came as a surprise to me because I started in what is like really, really high frequency. To me, high frequency data is data that comes out of exchanges while trading is happening live. So today, I'm not sure if you know this. If anybody sat in front of a neat terminal or Odin terminal actually punching in trains, how many people have actually sort of looked at a terminal? So you see these prices fluctuating, right? On that screen, typically the price for a security is going to change once, twice, thrice a second at most. That's the frequency with which it changes. But in fact, the activity in the market is much higher. The orders today hitting the exchange are coming in at sometimes hundreds of thousands of orders in milliseconds. High frequency data is basically access to that data, which is today available. So you can have servers sitting inside the exchange's own data centers. When they feed you information about every order that comes into the market, every transaction that takes place, every order that is canceled, right? And this is a huge ton of data. On average, the NSE today, I believe, generates about 20-25 gigabytes of data every day, just telling you that an order came in, an order got canceled, or a trade took place. Massive amounts of data, which is processed by high frequency trading firms to build models and to build forecasts that are sometimes as short as 5 seconds or 10 seconds. Right? So just guessing what the price is going to do in the next 10 seconds, acting on that and making money from that, that's one category, and they use high frequency data. And then finally, there is this box in red, alternative data. This is a very general term. This is one of the fastest growing data source for the investing and trading community in the world today. Alternative data is everything that is not the rest. In fact, so some people would even say news is alternative data, but I tend not to do that. For example, what would qualify as alternative data? Twitter feeds, right? Every tweet that is being put out on Twitter, if you could potentially use that to trade. You've got satellite imagery data. There's some interesting story I'll tell you about how satellite data is being used today. So imagery data, then you've got scandalous amount of data being collected by mobile phones that you install an app and you don't know, and there's this massive amount of data that is being fed back to companies, and there are some large companies in the world who get access to data from millions and millions of users. They are reselling that data. Even if it is anonymized, so there's no privacy concern per se, but there's massive amount of data being generated there. There's data that is coming out of companies like, for example. Right, today, so Nielsen does this survey of modern retail. Right, once a month or once a quarter, they come out with a report about every barcode level sales data in by region, etc. There's a massive report that they come out. But they used to come out, say, every month or every quarter. Today, for the likes of, right, you've got this data being generated every day, right? This is digitally captured. It's just a footprint for them. If you were, if you are a hedge fund and you talk to them, you can get this data on a real-time basis. That what is selling, is Parle G seeing a dip in demand? Is a particular product ramping up? You've got much, much more real-time information on what is happening in the market. So this, the sheer number of sources of data that are being generated and being used is exploding. We'll talk something about that. So there are six kinds of inputs that can go into a systematic strategy. And finally, there's time frame. There is the high frequency that I'm saying, where you can be forecasting stuff for 5 to 10 seconds. There is intraday mid frequency, which is what a lot of brokers in India today do, where the typical holding period is 30 minutes to an hour. There's end of day strategies. I like to put this in the buy today, sell tomorrow kind of calls that you get on CNBC, right? Just sort of one day holding periods, and there's multi-day, multi-week holding periods, and then there's the long-term investing. All of these are amenable to systematic or algorithmic investing or algorithmic trading.
There's one question.
Yeah.
So
sure.
So basically, again, the second way of it. In that is because we need to define the steps. Can we define all the steps in one go? But then how quickly we can react on those things?
So two parts of the question. First is the hypothesis that algo trading is about reacting to price. But it's not necessarily true. Right? It can react to, like I said, there are these six sources of input. Price is just one input into the process. as for reacting to news, etc., you can in fact react to news extremely fast. So for as an example, Reuters, Bloomberg, etc., all of these companies, whenever there is embargoed news, right, when there is a number that is released by the RBI or the US Fed, etc., it comes out as breaking news. But these companies also now have digital services where you get an electronic feed that a machine can read. Right? So the moment at 12, if a number has to go out, it will come on their website. It will also fed with extremely low latency into a trading system. You can have a system that is using that, that's news technically, and you can use that to react, and that reaction can be extremely fast. Or there are systems that are now looking at tweets, and I'm sure there are strategies today that are just watching Donald Trump's tweets, right, and just assessing it. If there's something crazy about something, you can react, and that reaction can be, even before it really refreshes on your Twitter feed, it's done, right? So that can be extremely fast, and yes, it can be good.
And how machine learning is
Machine learning is one part of it, and we'll talk about. So machine learning actually works on different parts of the investing or trading process. Okay, so we've looked at the time frame, we've looked at the inputs, we've looked at the kind of strategies that there can be. How do you put it together into a system? Right? So first of all, you have to decide what is the asset class you're going to be trading, like right? What securities you're going to be trading. So you could choose large cap Indian equities, you could choose global energy commodities, anything, but you have to define what you are going to be trading. Then you have to define what kind of strategy you are going to do. Are you going to be forecasting? Are you trying to do a long short strategy? You have to know that. You have to decide what kind of inputs you are going to use to do that. So if you're a technical, if you're a technical trader, you would say that I'm just going to look at price volume data and I'm going to build my strategy based on that. Or you could be, even if you're doing global energy, see, you could have a news-based system. But you choose what your inputs are going to be. Then you do the hard bit to actually arrange for that. Like, this is insanely hard, even for very ordinary things, right? Even for price data, right? End of day closing price data. It seems like the simplest thing. You could go to LSE's website and you could download price data, is what you think. But the price data that you get from LSE, for example, is so-called unadjusted data, right? So you've got, so if you went back 5 years and you got the price of any stock that underwent a split or a bonus, etc., the prices are adjusted. You will need to clean that up. For that, you will need what the bonus and split history has been. So that needs to be correct and clean, etc. And then you need to clean up your prices. And these are critical things, because if you don't do that, your any statistics that you're going to run could completely bomb. Right? For example, your algo said buy something, and then you're just looking at the unprocessed history of the price, and the stock actually underwent a split. You would think that you lost a 1-to-5 five-way split. You would think you lost 80% of your capital when you've not actually sold, right? So you need that clean price data. When you look at fundamentals data, you can look at capital line, prowess, whatever, and you think you can just download all of that data and you can use that data in your systems. But there's a problem with that as well, because companies often report slightly differently and prowess will make adjustments to those financials in a certain way. Capital line will adjust it certain ways. Then if the company restates their financials, prowess will update historical data, right? So you will not know what the financials looked like back in 2016. After the restatement, 2018, those numbers are different, which is something that you won't have known in 2016. If you build a strategy that uses that data without thinking about when it was actually available, again, you'll get bad results. So the data piece is extremely hard, and you have to be very careful about how clean it is, how reliable it is, and whether you can actually get it going forward. Right? So you arrange for data, and then you start get into a loop. You hypothesize on alpha.
With the proliferation of AI and machine learning now, at least those people who are using them, step 2 and 3 kind of getting interchanged. So they arrange for data and then choose or search for a strategy in that data?
Yes and no. If you what typically happens is you look at what data might be available and then you choose what kind of strategy you want to do. If you leave it really open, then it will be extremely hard to, because there is a far too wider space for even ML algorithms or AI algorithms to actually find a strategy. And you actually run the risk of getting into a data mining bias. So at some level you have to narrow it down. So you may not nail it down exactly and say exactly ye karna hai, but it has to be a fairly narrow search space for AI to be able to help you with that. But yes, you do look at what kind of data might be available before you decide what kind of strategy you want to use. That is definitely
right. My question was, what is the strategy you decide and then you look whether that strategy is working, or do you actually mine the data for the strategy?
Oh, so we move to the next step, hypothesis and alpha and backtest. So you could mine the data and find a strategy, but again, you would have to have some kind of structure predefined, right? So for example, in high frequency, I can tell you, what we look at is if we take 500 variables and we look for whether certain variables are predictive of returns, and then we'll build a strategy using those variables. I think that's what you were saying. There is a risk though. So you can do that, that happens. The risk with that is that these things can be just correlations that don't work in the future. So there's a lot of work that you have to do. If you're just using data mining to build a strategy, to make sure that you are not doing what is known as overfitting. But I think, again,
so that's where your paper trade will get, right?
Yes. So, just sort of stepping back on a step, I think. So what you do is you hypothesize an alpha, right? This is, so even when you choose the variables, by the way, so that is also a hypothesis that these 500 variables or these 100 variables or these 10 variables have some kind of predictive power. You have to hypothesize that. Then you actually test. Right? Now, what those parameters are going to be could actually be selected by a machine learning algorithm. But ultimately, you get some strategy and then you backtest. You see whether it actually makes money, and then you do a lot of sensitivity tests, etc. And it's very possible that it does not work. Then you go back to changing your hypothesis. You'll add some variables, you'll think of something else, etc. In a more simplified setting, let's say your hypothesis was that shorting at price earnings above 40 and buying at price earnings below 10 and holding in the interim period, that's the strategy. And then you can actually backtest it and say it does not work. Then you might add another filter. You say only, we'll only do this for stocks in a certain sector, etc. Right? What you can end up doing in this process. So this sounds good. You might say actually, in fact, what you could do is that 10 and 40 by each, maybe I'll do 39 as the point to short, or 37 as a point to short, or 12 as a point to buy on the price earning multiple. This actually creates a big risk of data mining, right? So you've got historical data and you sort of just tweak this. And here there is this human element of thought in some sense. You think, what I'm tweaking is that supposed to be, is your strategy supposed to be sensitive to the parameter? Say your strategy works at 39 as a multiple, doesn't work at 38, doesn't work at 40. Right, then you know there is a problem. So those kind of things happen a lot with algo strategies. And you have to be, but this loop is basically what you do. You hypothesize an alpha, you quantify it, you test whether it would actually have made money, etc. You go through this loop until you have something that works. Then you decide on the risk limits and then you paper trade. Right? You simulate typically. You will actually say, okay, this strategy now will run in the real market. This is used to avoid data mining bias that I just told you. That maybe this worked for the last 10 years, but it won't work going forward because I've done some crazy tweaking there. I've done an ROE filter of 22.5% instead of like a generic 20%. So you test that, and if it makes money, even going forward in a period that you've not used to tweak your strategy, then you would deploy it. Like this is sort of the framework with which any algo strategy works. Sometimes you can skip the paper trading if you know that you have good systems to test for data mining, etc. This is a statistical thing.
Typically, how much time does it take to whatever?
So in high frequency, I know it could take you a year, year and a half to put everything together. If you're going to take Greenblatt's magic formula, you could probably do it in a week. So it really depends on what kind of data, whether the data is available, how much cleaning does it need, how sensitive is your strategy to lots of factors. So it's really all over the place. So here's a strategy, right? So in theory they say that there's no difference between theory and practice. But in practice, there is a difference between theory and practice. So here's the theory, right? I said that we can do base rate based investing. You could run a screen and whatever names come up, you could buy all of those names, right? That's one strategy. That's a valid algo strategy. So let's say you say, okay, based on what we just spoke about, you choose a universe, large cap Indian stocks. You say the strategy type is a long only directional strategy. Your alpha is high quality and low valuation, as we saw. High ROE is 15% or above, and price to book less than 2. That's what my alpha is going to be. And the data that I'm going to need to do this is the quarterly financials and the price data. Right? Now this looks like a fairly well-defined strategy. There is nothing much to worry about here. And you could, in theory, write this up. And honestly, you don't even need a computer to do this. You could do this in Excel. By the way, and so there is no requirement for an algo strategy to be, you know, written up in Python and do everything automatically. It's very much possible to build an algo strategy in Excel or even on paper, as long as you're following objective rules and that strategy tells you, you don't have to apply your mind per se. That's a valid algo strategy. And this looks like it fits the definition, right? But this is what happens in practice. Large cap Indian stocks. This definition, right? So SEBI has given us a definition today. There's top 100 by market cap, those are the large cap stocks. But since you're going to be back testing this, what was the state in 2010? How are you going to define what large cap was back in 2010? So today, for example, what you would do, you would say any company with a market cap of more than 30,000 crores is large cap. But that's the definition today, because you know what most companies' market cap is today. If you try and do this for 2010, your universe will be much smaller, etc. And then over the period of time, the companies in the large cap category will keep changing, right? So how is your strategy going to cope with that? Supposing you got a so-called large cap stock in your portfolio, and then over the period that you are testing, it actually drops out of the large cap index. What are you going to do about it? Are you going to take it out of the portfolio? Do you still hold on to it? You need to define that, right? So it's not that straightforward to say, okay, my strategy is large cap stock. You have to say what you do when things change, what it was historically. ROE, amazingly, ROE, right? Sounds like straightforward. ROE greater than 15%, and we talk as if we all accept that ROE is ROE, but it's not, right? Anybody who's done, who's been an analyst, top analyst, especially was ROE is like, kuch bhi ho sakta, because you take the earnings, and this particular company, this pharma company, and the analyst looks at it and says, you know what, this guy is depreciating, amortizing the goodwill over a, they bought some IP and they're amortizing it over a much longer period, I'm going to shorten the period. What's going to happen? Your earnings are going to go down. The moment your earnings go down, so he's adjusting the earnings. So the ROE number this guy sees is different from what Bloomberg is going to tell you. Bloomberg throws you a number of ROE. It's just going to take reported earnings, divide by reported equity, and you're done, right? But I could define the equity in ROE, I could take the average over to previous year and current year. I could look at last year's equity as the denominator. I could look at the, as we learned in CFA, the share weighted equity, right? If the shares were issued in the middle of the year, I might adjust for that. So the ROE is not the ROE. You need to decide what I'm going to call the ROE. Am I going to adjust earnings for exceptional items? Am I going to take cyclically adjusted earnings? So it's all over the place. ROE is not one number. So when you write a strategy, you need to define that very, very sharply. Quarterly financials, right? This thing is, like I said, you're looking at 10 years history. If there is a restatement of financials, I know for a fact in Ace Equity, for example, they'll just update the historical numbers, right? So supposing you were sitting in June of 2011, and you looked at the financials of the company, especially in power sector, incredibly the revenue numbers will change over time. So 1 year, the closing 2016-17, the revenue number was X. Go up to the next year, almost invariably the revenue number for the then previous year would be different, right? I'm not talking about adjustments to the earnings or something, demerger, kuch nahi. Revenue number changes. Right? And what is AS and all these people are going to do? They'll take, when you move to the next year, they will update those earnings. Now, if you have got a strategy that is using this historical data, these are sort of the nuances within, just some of the nuances within algo investing. Right? So if somebody tells you, ki ye meri strategy hai, and you will think, oh god, this guy has made a lot of money, I'm going to go and do this. It's not going to work because there's like a hazard different things that he's tweaked in that strategy to make it actually work. Now I did say that, you know, it sounded like algos are quite immune. Once you've got a system, it sort of works, etc., etc. But there is in fact a lot of like human biases. We've got greed and fear and all of those things. You've got algos also have a problem, this look ahead bias. So for example, the thing that I just told you about, okay, you've got restated numbers in your data, you've got a look ahead bias. Or if you've got a strategy that assumes, for example, let's say you rebalance your portfolio once a year, right? And you say, I'm going to rebalance at the end of the financial year, 31st March, is when I rebalance my portfolio. And what I do is I sort companies by price to book and I buy the cheapest 10% of companies by price to book. What you could do is you could look at the historical, this data that you're getting from this and forget restating or whatever. You've got these, and on the 31st March, you take the price of 31st March. You look at the book equity on 31st of March, you calculate the price to book, and you buy your, you build your portfolio, you backtest this, and you make crazy money. I can tell you, even without actually having done this, I can tell you if you just do this, 31st March ki price divided by 31st March ki equity, and you backtest this strategy, buying cheap stocks, you're going to make a crazy load of money. And why is that? Because in fact, on 31st of March, nobody actually knew what the equity of the company looked like. It, usually not up till June, till you know for most companies what the equity was. So the price on 31st of March would not reflect that reality. So if you just sort based on that, and you backtest this, you look like a genius, but you've introduced what is look ahead bias. Your algo seems to know things that in reality, the world does not know until much later. That's one big error that you could make. You could have hindsight bias, like we talked about, Satyam, right? But the way it works in algos is, you know, you look at, you say, give me the big stocks currently, largest stocks, and I want to go back to 2010 and look what their data was, and I'm going to basically simulate my strategy on that. What's going to end up happening is that all the companies that died in the interim, or actually, you know what, that's an example of survivorship bias. Hindsight bias is more interesting. So let's say you are building a strategy. You're saying I'm going to look at the BSE 500, but I'm going to, my strategy is not going to buy PSU stocks. Okay? So this is a strategy that might make a lot of sense sitting today in 2020. You would say that my strategy, I don't invest in PSU stocks because PSU stocks are usually a very bad risk. And so, and now I have no bias, right? So I'm going to now test this strategy over the last 20 years. And that could be a price to book based strategy or any kind of strategy. And it might do extremely well. But you've got a hindsight bias here, right? You're sitting today knowing that in the last 20 years, maybe PSU stocks have not done well, or last 10 years, PSU stocks have not done well. And so you built this strategy and it looks like an objective strategy, but there is no reason to think that tomorrow the PSU stocks are not going to zoom. Right? So there is a hindsight bias, and you don't really understand that you've introduced this bias. So there are products in the market today that actually make that mistake. You need to sort of be aware of that. There's survivorship bias, like I said, Satyam died, and you might not actually put it in your portfolio back in 2008, knowing that it died. Finally, there's data mining. Again, like I said, your strategy, if you're tuning it to the point where the price earning multiple or the price to book multiple is, you know, going from 6, so 6.2 is a good entry, 6.3 is a good entry, you're doing that, your strategy is going to eventually burn. Might even work for a while, it'll eventually burn. And here are the other pitfalls. Typically when you're writing a strategy, you will say, here's an example. So I'm going to buy a stock when it goes down, and then I'm going to sell when it goes up 10%. So if it's down 10%, I buy some, it goes up 10%, I sell. Right? A lot of people love this strategy. It's something, if it goes down another 10%, I'll buy one more lot. It's a very common strategy. Almost everybody who begins to do algo trading wants to do this. Right? The thing they don't think about is, supposing the stock is at 100 and you've just bought one lot, and then it went up to 110 and your algo tells sell, then goes up to 120, then goes up to 130, and then what are you going to do? Right? You sold out the one position you picked up, and now you don't know what to do because it's beyond, and you only buy when it goes down. And suppose you went up to 120 and then came back to 110, are you going to buy now? All of those things you have to actually think of put it into a system ahead of time and then backtest whether that works, right? And it's crazy how often you would miss the situation. This happens even more in options. So a lot of brokers I've talked to over time, they want to trade in options because it's supposedly easy money. So what they tell you is that, you know, Nifty call options, I'll just write options when it goes up to X, I'm going to write a put option when it goes down, I'm going to write a call option, etc., things like that. And then eventually at the end of the month, Nifty zyada move karta nahi hai. So net-net will make money. Except that they've not thought about what happens if the volatility spikes in the index. If you have a massive short options portfolio, and it seems that they are hedged, but each way there is going to be a volatility spike, and they've not thought about whether there is a stop loss on that. Right? They will backtest this strategy without worrying of what the interim portfolio did. And when they go live and the portfolio, you know, the volatility spikes and they are looking at massive drawdowns, they'll not know what to do. And then algo will not be able to tell them what to do. And that's it, just good. So being able to think through all the things that could happen is something that you have to worry about and you have to put it into your strategy. Will the data be available? There's another thing, classic. You look at auto sales data and you build your strategy, but are you sure that you will be able to have access to it going forward? You can look at capital line and get the data, but going forward, are you going to be able to get the data in time to feed your strategy? Have you accounted for trading costs? This is another big one. So a lot of candlestick based strategies, right? Open, high, low, close based strategies, even on a 5-minute basis. People do this. You look at the close price and you look at and you might build a model where you can forecast what's going to happen in the next 15 minutes. So this strategy will apparently make a lot of money. Except when you go out into the market and you try to trade this, you realize that the open, high, low, close data is based on trades. Okay, so here's what happens. Especially for thinly traded stocks, the spread between the price could be, say, the buyer is at 1000 and the seller is at 1001. So 1 rupee spread. Very typical. The last trade happened to happen at 1000 rupees. Okay, that's what's going to show up in your data. And your strategy is saying buy. But when you go out and actually try to buy it, if you were in the real market, you would actually get it at 1001. Right? That 1 rupee spread, if your strategy, if you don't think about that 1 rupee spread, it might turn out that eventually you don't make any money at all when you go out and trade in the market. It can get worse for cheaper stocks because if you've not thought about your STT and all of those things, there's a 5 paisa spread. In a stock, the 20 rupee stock, a 5 paisa spread is 25 bips. That's 25 basis points ka spread that you're going to pay just to transact in that strategy. And if your total returns are like 20 bips, looks like a great strategy when you're doing high frequency trading, 20 bips, but when you go and execute, it won't work. So you have to think about what the transaction costs is. And actually, a very interesting real case and where it can go wrong. I did this, but really wrong. There's something called a put call parity strategy. We all studied put call parity, right? There's this nice, beautiful equation that says if the put is priced at this, then the call should be priced at this, etc., etc. So we were looking at Nifty options, and we saw that there is this mismatch in the price. The put call parity was not working, like seriously broken. Something is wrong. Okay? This looks like a great thing to, you know, this pure R. I don't know why it exists. Let me go and transact. Thankfully, we did it with 5 lots or something. We took this position and there's 20 days to expiry and we're sitting with this position and it's like, okay, eventually it's going to, even if it doesn't converge, when it settles, I'm going to make money, it doesn't matter. So as it happens, we do get to settlement without the convergence happening. And we're looking at the price and like, great, this is going to settle and I'm going to make money. So finally the settlement, sab kuch ho gaya, and we paid the transaction cost, we paid everything, we realized we lost money. Why was that? Because we didn't realize that when an option is actually exercised, you pay an STT on the whole notional and everything bomb, right? So you can build a strategy, it looks great on paper, this is going to converge, I'm going to make a ton of money, and you go live and you bomb, right? So you need to think very carefully about trading costs. The ability to actually put on a trade, so if your system says short, you can't really short. If you're looking at end of day closing prices, that's another story altogether. Because you're going to only be able to trade the next day and maybe you'll not even catch the opening price and that could be a gap up, gap down, all sorts of things. Right, so that's just... And finally, the psychology of running an algo strategy. The algo itself can have no emotion whatsoever. It'll sit through the volatility, doesn't matter. The problem is, you might actually say this is way too much of a drawdown, I don't trust the strategy I'm giving this. And it happens to the best of us. Even at Renaissance, which you, I don't know if you've heard the recent book that's come out, even at Renaissance this has happened, where people will cut back on provisions just because they can't handle the volatility. The algo is not complaining, but since it's a human who actually put the money in, but like Jatin said, if you're
the algo is effectively like the money manager, and you
because the algo that feels whatever it feels about the market, you cut your position. So you need to have a strategy that's not so volatile that you can't take the pain. Right, so please just how everything is put together, what goes into it, what are the steps, what can the problems be realistically, etc. This is what that universe looks like. I'm going to switch gears now. We'll talk about how the world of these algo investing and discretionary investing, how they are actually beginning to interact. There used to be, you know, time was when they were very different worlds. There were these algo guys, they lived in their own world, and the discretionary guys lived in their own world, and their only interaction, if any, was in the market. When it's possible that a mutual fund is buying something and there is an algo that is actually selling it the shares. That was the only interaction that was taking place. Their worlds were completely different. These guys are working on price, these guys are working on fundamentals, price and separate. That's changing. Okay. So it's just a schematic. What happens is typically you run a screen. And like I said, you just imagine a strategy that uses a screen to buy stocks. Right? And the screen is ROE based, or price to book based, or whatever. And then the typical discretionary investor is actually going to do scuttle butt, it's going to meet the management, it's going to use the subjective judgment, it's going to see what the trends are like, etc. There are things that it's going to build there. That's what the world looked like typically. Before I say, so, by the way, so you said, you know, lots of mutual funds, but there are in fact a very, very well-known algo investing instrument that's available to everybody. And you're all aware of it. Do you know what that is? ETFs. Nifty. Nifty is perhaps the best known algo investing instrument. We may never have thought of it like that. But that's exactly what it is. Right? It's an extremely systematic way of selecting stocks. With the 50 largest stocks, you weight them by market cap. And you eliminate certain stocks that have liquidity constraints, etc. It's extremely mathematical. It's an algo. So if you think that you're not already sort of exposed to algo investing, you are. So, well, that's one extreme of algo investing, of course. The other thing that's happened is, and we'll actually go back to that diagram I talked about, you know, portfolio and then the money started. This is what has happened. So I think until last year, or even now, I think a lot of people say that the only remaining edge in the markets today is a behavioral edge. Right? Because information is available to everybody, everybody can do the analysis. So the only edge that you have is behavior. Can you avoid greed? Can you avoid fear, etc., etc.? But in fact, this is changing. This is changing very, very rapidly. We are back to a state where all three edges, the informational edge, the analytical edge, and the behavioral edge, all of them are in play. All of them are getting transformed once again because of AI, because of digital data, and because of just how much you can do with this new kind of information. So here's that chart again. What's happening is, we started with base rates and we said that, you know, only measurable things are what can go into an algo investing strategy. What's happening now is a lot of this stuff on the right, which was supposed to be stuff that only humans could do, which was, you know, extremely discretionary, that is getting quantified. Scuttlebutt is getting quantified in certain ways. Just like I said, if you looked at, you know, Grofer, say if you tied up with Grofer and said, give me your sales data, that's scuttlebutt, right? That's the kind of thing that 2.2 could have done with Manpasar. Like, is it actually selling? Well, statistical sample, you're right. Even in Nielsen data, it's statistical data. Even your scuttlebutt is statistical data. You don't know exact sales, but you go to 50 stores and you say, yeah, many bigger, to matlab nahi bigger. Now you can do it digitally. Once you can do it digitally, once that data can be collected digitally, it can be processed digitally, it can be quantified, it can go into a strategy, moves out of the realm of the discretionary investor, moves into the realm of algo investing. Right? That's scuttlebutt. Even subjective judgments about management. So there are people who are doing studies by looking at the annual reports, the MD&A, and they start measuring the optimism that the management has. Or whether the management actually talks about capital appreciation as opposed to vanity metrics. They've backtested these things. They've been able to quantify whether a certain management is in general over optimistic, right? Do it in the text processing on annual reports which are digitally available, right? And you and I can probably look at 10, 20, 50, 100 companies. These systems will take all 500 of the BSE 500 companies and they'll run it, right? And that's, so that is also moving into the realm of algorithmic investing. So there's more and more stuff that is stopped being an edge for us as people. It's moved into the realm of algorithms, which is why the analytical edge is now again in play. Almost everybody knows how to read, or at least institutions or large enough people can read these annual reports and make sense of it. But now the amount of sense you can make of it is increasing because of machines, because of the, all the biases are going away, because you can do it at scale, you can do it extremely fast. All of that is moving. What kind of stuff? ESG assessments, right? Just basic accounting checks, automated. You can do all of that automatically. The environmental impact, the social impact, a lot of these things are being done automatically. Accounting generators, public perception using social media, you've got scuttlebutt, management quality, all of this, I just talked about this. All of this stuff, people are, it's not like it's done, it's not like it's over for humans, but this is being done very, very quickly, very, very effectively, not so much in India, but globally, definitely. It's gotten to the point where, this is what BlackRock has to say about investing. So, if you're just depending on annual reports, etc., maybe you are going to lose your edge with time. So, even if you're not going to do algo investing, you're going to have to think, what is it that you are going to bring to the table when algos have done all of this, right? So, for example, nobody today thinks that I'm very smart. Ki main price to book mein sort karke stocks kharidta hu. Great at Graham's time. Right, by the way, so price to earnings ke basis par if you built a portfolio, you would have been super smart because nobody looked at that back then. So back then that was smart, but today nobody thinks that looking at price to earnings and then just building a portfolio based on that is super smart. Right? Because it became the domain of algos. Similarly, a lot of this stuff is going to move into what algos do. So as discretionary investors, the very least that we have to do is two things. One, we have to adopt more and more of this into our process and say, okay, I'm going to depend on a program to just come up with all of these tools. The way I use screens on earnings multiples and price to book multiples, I'm going to have to learn how to use these tools to do a lot more of the assessment for me. And then second, I have to think about what is the value I'm going to bring to the table. Because it tools to sabke paas hai, right? Today everybody has Excel, tomorrow everybody is going to have Python libraries that will do all of this processing and give you the data. What are you going to bring to the table? Maybe we have to move up the value chain and think about, can we really think about what the 10-year trend is going to look like, right? Which is not necessarily going to show up in numbers. Can we think about what the 10-year trend is going to look like? What the world is going to look like in 10 years? I think that's still far out for machines to be able to do. Maybe that's where we're going to have to add value. But we'll have to think, constantly look at what algos can do today and think what we bring to the table over and above what algos are doing. Right? And the reason algos can do this, do all of this, is because this duality. And this is where machine learning becomes important. You've got a lot of this data being generated, captured digitally, then you've got this ability to analyze. There are tools that can analyze earnings calls, right? So it's pure audio. And there are hedge funds that are actually using audio analysis to do tone analysis of management, right? That's the level of stuff that you can do. Because the first step was that all of these calls become digitally available. And then the next thing was that you've got ability to analyze audio. And because you've got ability to analyze video, now there's more and more stuff, okay, let's capture even this particular type of data and audio and make it available. Right? Well, image processing. So that story that we come to. So there's a story actually that I want to, this duality of ability to process information and the kind of information that actually becomes available for analysis. So there's a company called Planet Labs. Now it's called Planet Inc. These guys came up with this tiny 4 kilogram satellite. Right? This big, it's a box, 4 kgs. All it has is a camera and a transmitter, right? And they launched dozens of these into space. What these satellites are, they look down at Earth, right? So you've got Earth rotating like this. They're all lined along one longitude. You're all looking down at Earth from pole to pole. And as the Earth turns, we take a picture. We're constantly taking pictures of the Earth. Right? And there's that data is streamed back. So now you've got, today, humanity has got a daily picture of every point on the planet at a 1 meter resolution. Every day. Right? We can look at every point on Earth, every day what it looks like. Right? This is the data that's available. Next, on top of this data, the company called Orbital Insights. That company now takes in all of this data. Just imagine the size of this data and the complexity of processing it. And today they can tell you what is happening, for example, in the Amazon rainforest. If there is a fire, where it has spread to. If there is a plant that a company was constructing, what stage of construction have they got to. All of this they can process and they can tell you on a day-to-day basis. Right? L&T puts up a new plant, uski sarke ban gaya, uska main unit ban gaya. Every day you know this. Right? And you can feed this into an algorithm. And there you have it. Right? So this image processing capability came in, and then they decide to launch this satellite, and then you've got this loop. And more information is now being fed. You people have low-flying aircraft that are capturing data of parking lots in front of Walmart. Right? This is a classical story that everybody tells now. Right? And you measure how many cars there are. Or there's Foursquare. Is everybody here familiar with Foursquare? We were all heard of Foursquare. Not the Facebook generation, I guess. So Foursquare was an app basically where you could check in. Okay, I'm at the airport, I'm at this restaurant, etc., etc. People love to do that for some reason. Foursquare, what they did was they used to collect this data for several years. And at some point, Chipotle is a restaurant chain in the US. Mexican food. Pretty good. Just based on the check-in data that they got. Right? This is people volunteering this information. And there's obviously not everybody going to Chipotle is checking in on Foursquare, but you know, a lot of them are. 2 weeks ahead of the earnings announcement, Foursquare was able to come up with a forecast for the earnings. This is a big drop, by the way. People were not expecting it. And he comes back and says, Chipotle's earnings are going to be down and this is what they're going to be. 2 weeks ahead of the actual announcement. And they came spot on, like very small error. Based on not stuff that you and I could have. This company has it, and now it's available for sale on a platform called Quantum.
Actually, there's a better data set on this, so the retail brands, the credit cards,
swipe measure
is now available along with geotagging.
There you are.
So,
there is a mad rush right now amongst hedge funds in the world to lap up these, come up with exclusive tie-ups. So they're doing exclusive tie-ups. So they've got the data, nobody else has got it. Right, so even regulation will have to adapt to how this is working. But that's the thing, that's the amount of stuff that's happening. And this, it's a duality. Because you can process this data, more people are capturing it because they know they can sell it for value. And this is driving that cycle. So that's the story. Now, what do you do about it? What you can do about it is, first step, validate your screen. If you're using screens, find out whether they are even useful. Are they actually predictive of great returns going forward? This is the most basic that you can do. You can look at what growth performance for your portfolio and see whether it was that you were actually getting lucky or there were systematic factors that drove it. And now that you understand what those systematic factors would be, was I actually buying stocks and that's why I got the returns? Or was it that I was buying high quality stocks and that drove the returns? You know, you can actually measure that and you can understand your own investing. In the heat of the moment, that decision you could have taken for any number of reasons. But looking back, you can systematically quantify. Like, is there a style that I'm following? And third is you can quantify your decision. For example, cyclicals, Jatin said, right, again, if you are invested in a cyclical and if earnings and the multiples are at an all-time high, exit or reduce value. Quantify this, write it down. Try and make it as precise and what does all-time high mean? What does high all-time high multiple mean, etc. Try and codify it. At the very least, that will make it better. You can systematize this. Kalko, if you get an intern to help you out with stuff, you can look at those rules, it can help you. At least at that level, you begin to compete with these systematic strategies that are taking over the world. And if you think that, you know, ultimately investing is this soft thing and computers will not eventually get it. It's not necessary, right? Do you recognize this company? The company called Vevo. they are driving around in San Francisco without drivers, right? We used to think driving is very human, right? And well, I know they will not survive on the Indian roads right now. They eventually will, right? So the same can happen to investing. So you have to think what your alpha is going to be. Are you going to join the forces? Are you going to add to it? In any case, you can't ignore it. That's what I have to say.
So we are completely out of time. We got ready to that question. You can catch hold of Parijat over lunch and ask any questions in there. So in the morning I was reading this tweet. So during an interview with ET Now, Professor Damodaran said, and I quote, "Active investing for the most part is lazy and inefficient. It always been lazy and inefficient. Most portfolio managers were charging 1.52% of your money to manage it by buying low PE stocks blindly and hoping that they could go up." So, if that is what we are doing, then we probably won't be able to survive with this level of algo trading happening in the market. So we need to, whether we like it or not, but we can't ignore algo trading. And we have many things to learn or unlearn. And thank you, Parijat, for starting that process for us. Thank you very much for your time. I would invite Jitendra Chawla, Director, CFA Society India, to present token of appreciation to Parijat.